The New Testament lesson now does come from the second chapter of Luke and begins at the 8th verse. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly, a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest of heaven, on earth peace to those whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and let us see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what they had been told about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of the word. And now we're going to sing hymn number 246, and we're going to stand for joy, joy to the world. 246. Become like our parents. There's five things that we need to look at. The number five reason is you know you're getting old because everything hurts and nothing works. Number four, you know you're getting older because your knees buckle, but your belt doesn't. The number three reason you know you're getting older, when you know the answers and nobody asks you the questions. Now these two really concern the men. The little gray-haired lady you help across the street, that's your wife. And the number one reason you know you're getting older, when you see a pretty lady go by, your pacemaker makes the garage door goes up and down. And so these are the things that happen to us as we grow older. And they're kind of funny, actually. But here we're faced with a situation where things were, in fact, getting older. It had been 400 years since the prophets had spoke between the Testaments. 400 years, and the people were given this opportunity, God's people were given this opportunity to figure this whole thing out. To take the scriptures that were written on the papyrus and all the other places, and the stories that were given all around the campfires, and as they nomadically went across the wilderness, and they came into the land of they were promised with the milk and honey, and they fought through the land of Canaan. They came and they finally settled in Jerusalem. Their temple was destroyed, and they were carried off into Babylonia. Somehow they come back and rebuild the temple. And then there's this 400-year period. I think God had it right. Let me prove to them they can't do this. They always think they can. They always think that if they're just left to themselves, they'll figure everything out. Because they know the stories, they know the words, so they're going to figure this whole thing out. But the truth is, they couldn't figure it out. And at this particular time, when the baby was born in Bethlehem, it was a very corrupt time. It was a very corrupt time within the Roman government. It was a very corrupt time within the temple authorities and the temple itself. Jesus would say, "You have made our father's house a den of robbers." He would say, "You are like a painted whitewashed tomb, just crystal beautiful on the outside, but full of nothing but decaying bones on the inside." The Pharisees had become rather narcissistic and a little showboating. They liked to go out and let everybody know exactly how wonderful they were. Instead of, "This is how wonderful God is, this is how wonderful I am for obeying God, you should like that." The Sadducees kind of aligned with the Roman government, and people didn't like that either. The scribes were still writing a lot of rules and regulations and all kinds of things that people really couldn't keep up with. And then they had enough rituals that they would be able to say, "I don't like you because you're unclean. I can find so many things wrong with you. Thou shalt not." And life had become "thou shalt not" instead of "thou shalt." And all of a sudden, the God of love seemed like some kind of tyrant that wanted to rule with an iron fist, and that's not what God wanted. And God said, "You're not figuring it out. I knew you couldn't do it. You can't make yourself perfect. So I'm going to make you perfect." Wow. And all you got to do is put yourself in the right place, open your heart, and I'll lead you right into the light. Now you see, that became a problem as well. But we are overcoming that. We really are. We're kind of, in the last 2,000 years, walking further away from the darkness and further into the light. We are getting it. It just takes a long, long time to do it. And it takes us to bring our attention, our focus, into doing it. And I think it's absolutely so appropriate that this angel who came out in the fields and in the surrounding area of Bethlehem, and the trumpets were sounding and the angels were singing, it didn't come out of the temple, it came out of the sky and it came out in the fields to these shepherds who were in the field. They couldn't keep all those rules and regulations. They couldn't do all the ritualistic things. They couldn't get into the temple because they had to keep the sheep. Often people thought they were unclean because they couldn't do all those things. We like our shepherds, but we don't want to be around them. And that is who the angels came to. And they came there, I believe, because they were out there in the quiet, away from the clanging and the banging and the rustle and everything else that's going on all around the city, all around everywhere else. They're sitting out in the field, they're looking up at the stars and the sun, and or the sun and they're looking up at the moon, and it gets quiet. I mean, it gets really quiet at night, doesn't it? If you're ever out there in the woods and it's at night, you just kind of settle down and you just can hear crickets. You know, you say that, you hear crickets, you hear these little things. If someone breaks a twig 50 yards away, you hear it snap. If you're sleeping in the dark and you hear this little mosquito buzzing around, it keeps you awake. You would never hear it in the daytime because you're open to hearing the slightest little sound. There was a newspaper article way back before there was telephones, back before there was certainly texts and emails and all those good and wonderful things. And they needed a telegraph operator. And so they advertised for a telegraph operator, and everybody wanted the job. They had all kinds of people come in for an interview, and they were all in this room, and this young man was walking in, last one in, he sits down. And everybody in that room begins talking with each other, going over, getting coffee. It gets a little loud in there. And as it goes on, this young man's sitting there, and he's kind of listening, and all of a sudden he gets up, and he walks right into the interview room, right past everybody else. And they all looked at him and they thought, wow, this guy's going to get tossed out of there for sure. Nobody told him to come in there. Pretty soon, the interviewer came out with the young man and said, everybody can go home. This young man here has got the job. And they said, they just went, you know, how could this be? We were here first. He just walks in there. And the interviewer said, the whole time that you were sitting here, if you would have listened very faintly, was being tapped out on the telegraph key, if you can hear this message, come on in the room, you have the job. Because we need somebody who isn't distracted. We need somebody who is focused. We need somebody who can get up above the clamor of everything else that's going on and can be there when everybody else misses it. Because you don't know. You have no idea the things that you're going to go across that, have from across that wire to you could be, very matter-of-factly, life and death. Now, normally, we probably don't have life and death situations going on. But we certainly do have life and death of the spirit, life and death of the soul, life and death of our faith, life and death of our hope, life and death of our vision, and all the other things that make us a whole person in Christ. Unless we bring ourselves out here, unless we separate ourselves, unless we come out into those fields, just like we are in the field now, we are here, and it was quiet, and we had music, we had God's word coming across to us. We have that time for prayer. We have that time just to concentrate, allow our hearts to be open so we can feel that very special presence. And that's the very thing that opened the birth of Jesus Christ, that very special, quiet presence. And that's why we're here tonight, for that presence. And then it opened us into, then, this great purpose that we have. The energy of Christ coming into the world has given us this wonderful something so much huger than we are, so much bigger than we can even imagine at times. But we have to have that greater purpose, or we feel like we're chained somewhere. We feel like we're locked up. We feel like there's a hole in our soul. We feel like we're not complete unless we have. There has to be more. There has to be more, or this life is nothing more than a cruel trick of nature. And I do not believe it's a cruel trick of nature. I believe we are created in creation for this larger purpose, to shine the light on the Lord Jesus Christ and to have that light shine within us. And we feel like, wow, that's something that's so big, I'm not sure I can handle all that. But God and the baby comes to us and says, if this little baby can come into this world And you can find the beauty in that. And this baby can overcome, and this baby can have the vision and the confidence. You are a beautiful, wonderful part of creation too.
I don't know. Remember the fairy tale Rapunzel? I haven't seen it or heard it for years, and I don't know if I can bring it the way it really was, but if I'm right, Rapunzel lived, I forget who, was an aunt or grandmother or something, witch, and the witch told Rapunzel that she was ugly, and the witch took all the mirrors out of the tower, so Rapunzel could never see herself. And so the more the witch said, "You're ugly," the more she believed it. And she's locked up in this tower, and her hair was growing long and all that kind of stuff. And she really believed that this is what she deserved. Because after all, nobody in their right mind would want me. And so she sat in the tower day after day, and she leaned looking out the tower window. And there, one day, there came a prince riding on a big steed. He'd come out, he stopped the horse, and he looked up, and he thought, "Oh my gosh, that's the most beautiful woman that I've ever seen." And Rapunzel's hair was so long it could reach clear down to the ground. And he said, "Rapunzel, Rapunzel, let down your hair." And he climbed up her tresses, he went into that big old window, and he got in there, and it was one of those chick flicks going on, you know what I mean? Everyone's heart was pounding, and here they are, and they're in each other's arms, oh my gosh. And she looks into his eyes, and what does she see? She sees her reflection. And she knows now she's not ugly. She knows, as a matter of fact, I'm beautiful. I was paralyzed, she thought. I was a prisoner in this tower, she thought. I was behind bars. I had no freedom whatsoever. But it ends with them rappelling down her hair and onto the horse and happy ever after. Now, I know it's a fairy tale, but I think that's what Christ has done for us. I think that when we look into the eyes of Christ, we see a worth in our soul that says, we are loved, we are needed, we are wanted. We can have, we can challenge, we can do great things. We can have vision. We can have faith even when people tell us there should be no faith. We can have hope when all hope seems to be dead. Because I'm no longer chained. I'm no longer behind bars. I'm no longer paralyzed. Because I know better. I know that this God loves me enough to die for me. This God loves me enough to take a bullet for me. Imagine that. Me. And I once thought I was worthless. Isn't that amazing? And so we see this greater purpose. And then we know we can have this trust because nobody except the Creator can have that kind of love for us. It's totally unconditional. We don't deserve it, but we have it. It's absolutely amazing. And I think the baby in the cradle tells us that same story. I mean, think of this little baby, you know, lying there in this manger, down in the straw. And it can't do anything for itself. And it's totally innocent. It hasn't done anything wrong. When it screams, the mother feeds it. When it screams, the mother changes its diaper. When it screams, everyone runs around trying to figure out how to make it stop screaming. But everybody loves it. It seems to be a real pain in the neck. But everybody loves it. Isn't it the same in our own families? This baby comes into the house, everybody gathers and they say, "Oh, that's the most beautiful baby I ever seen." And the truth is, it looks like a troll doll. Come on, some babies just do. But they're loved. It doesn't matter. They are totally loved. Strangers going down the street, they know there's a baby in the house. They're thinking to themselves, there's nothing more important in that house than that baby. And that's so true.
And that baby can trust that that's true. The baby knows if it throws its oatmeal on the floor, someone will clean it up. If it throws a spoon at somebody, someone will bring the spoon back. Someone will be there for it night and day, no matter where it goes, where it is taken. It's always going to get back as well. That's how the babies learn trust. And in that innocence and trust, we are told we can have that same kind of trust. There's something about the love of Jesus Christ, the love of God, that surrounds us in such a powerful way. If we open our hearts, we open the way we feel, we actually get down and we speak to this wonderful Creator, we're going to find a beauty and a preciousness that we cannot deny, nor can we even run away from, even if we wanted to. Because it's just that powerful. There was a professor and writer, I think his name was Ellswood Kalla. And he was in Singapore doing some lecturing at a seminary. And he mentioned that how he had come, and as he was going through the streets of Singapore, he saw this little boutique and this beautiful silk scarf was in there. So he went in, he bought this silk scarf, and he bought it for his young daughter. He thought, she loves things like this. And I know that this is just perfect for her. I can't wait to see her wearing this scarf. So, you know, he takes it home, he gives it to her, and she's thrilled. She's dancing around with it, she puts it around her neck, and she just wears it everywhere she goes, every dress that she has, every outfit, she always has a scarf. She has it hanging around her neck tight, she has it hanging around her neck down here, she has it around the waist, it ties, so part of it goes off to the side. She has it over her shoulders, whatever it is, she has it. And the father said, every time he looked at her, he said, wrapped in my love with that scarf, she's even more beautiful than I can ever imagine. Just wrapped in that love that's represented with that scarf. And I would suggest that we are wrapped in the love of Jesus Christ. We are wrapped in the love of God, the Creator. And because of that, we take on a very special glow. We take on a very special something that lets us take that light that we are given and pass it on to others. And I think that is what is part of our bigger purpose. I think that is our celebration. I think that is our joy as we continue with our service. May God bless us all this Christmas Eve. Amen. I think we have music now, do we?